are basically two classes of capping methods that we use for capping messenger RNAs. The first category is called enzymatic capping, in which we make the RNA and generally purify it, and then use vaccinia virus enzymes to cap and methylate the messenger RNA. The second category is co-transcriptional capping. And there are three generations of cap analogs that I just wanted to point out to you. The first generation was cap or mCap, and that worked kind of okay. Then there came kind of a revolution in this area, which was something called anti-reverse cap analog, which I'll tell you about a little bit later. And this one worked much better than the first generations, and this has kind of been the industry standard for a couple decades, really. And most recently, we at TriLink developed a new method, which we call CleanCap, which we think is going to be the third generation of capping, and I'm going to tell you about that in the next few slides here. But first, I want to tell you a little bit about the characteristics of the other capping methods. So enzymatic capping utilizes a vaccinia virus capping enzyme and a 2' O-methyltransferase. And you can get 100% capping if you drive this reaction to completion in most cases. The yields are a natural, unmodified cap structure, which may be good. And the cap one structure is less immunogenic in vivo. And so this gets you to a desirable capping state. But capping enzymes are costly at scale, and there's significant batch-to-batch enzymatic variations. They also use an unstable cofactor, which is S-adenosylmethionine. And the capping efficiency can vary, especially if you have a structured 5' end, which is often the case with these replicon RNAs I told you about earlier. You can get inefficient capping if you have a very strong structure at the 5' end, where you get variability. So in order to assess capping, we developed a capping assay that I'll walk you through in just a moment. So as Jim mentioned at the beginning, we're trying to assess the capping status of an RNA that may be millions of Daltons in size. And we're trying to distinguish a single methyl group in that sea of millions of Daltons. That's really difficult. So in order to do that, we utilize a strategy where we made a DNA zyme and cut off the very end of the RNA at a very specific location. And then we analyze that by LC-MS. Sometimes we'll include a phosphatase step to simplify the analysis of mono, di, and triphosphates. And over here on the right-hand side, you can see an example of an enzymatic capping reaction that's gone most of the way, but not entirely to completion. We're able to see an uncapped monophosphate, cap zero, and a little bit of triphosphate. And so this is what it looks like when an enzymatic capping does not go to completion. It can be much, much worse. This is actually a pretty good capping. All right, so the second possibility is to use a co-transcriptional capping strategy. And so I told you that the kind of the industry standard for the last 20 years or so has been ARCA. And it's called anti-reverse cap analog because it has a 2' or 3' O-methyl group here. And what that does is that prevents this RNA from elongating from this side. So this construct cannot go in backwards. It's kind of almost a symmetrical molecule. This forces it to go in the right direction. And that was the innovation of ARCA. Now, during a normal transcription initiation event, it looks like this. So you have a T7 promoter, and here at the edge of the blue circle is where the transcription starts, at the +1, +2, and +3 nucleotides outside of the promoter. Normally, you would initiate with GTP, but instead, you can initiate with this cap analog here, where again, you're initiating with G at the +1 position, but you have this all hanging off the end, and the polymerase seems to be okay. But these two reactions compete with each other. And so generally what you do is you use a large excess of the cap over GTP such that you get capping, because when you initiate with this, you get a triphosphate instead of a cap. And so in general, you're getting somewhere around 70 or 80% capping when you're using, say, a 4- or 5-fold excess of this. But this is the most expensive. So what are the characteristics of ARCA? Well, it yields cap zero, and I told you earlier that we think that that might not be such a good thing. You have a competition between GTP and the cap analog, and so you have to use large excesses of the cap analog. It gives you fairly reproducible capping, so that's good. So in general, you can get about 80% capping. However, there's significant amounts of transcriptional stuttering, which I'll show you in just a second. and the cap contains an unnatural 3' O-methyl group, which may be good or may be bad, something you would have to test. Now, if you get 80% capping, the rest of that material is 5' triphosphate, which we told you has the potential to be immunogenic. And so sometimes we'll include a phosphatase step to remove this residual triphosphate. And then in general, transcription by T7 polymerase likes to start with a G. It highly prefers a G. And so you're constrained in terms of the sequence you can use at the 5' end of your transcript. So this is just an example of a capping assay, a very typical one for ARCA, where here you can see the uncapped material is substantial. And then this is the cap zero material, and you get a lot of transcriptional stuttering. So this is the addition of untemplated nucleotides at the beginning of the transcription reaction. And we see this, this is a very typical kind of ARCA capping reaction. So in order to get around some of these obstacles, so the stuttering at the beginning, the inability to make a cap one structure co-transcriptionally, we came up with the idea of instead of using a dimer to cap, we'd use a trimer. And so here you can see it, the M7G and then two bases. These sit down at the plus one and the plus two position. And this allows us to bring in a methyl group here to make cap one co-transcriptionally. And this actually caps extremely efficiently. We can also make a cap two structure by using a tetramer, where we bind to the plus one and the plus two and plus three position, bringing in two methyl groups, and this allows us to achieve cap two structures. And again, this is very early days. We're just getting to the point of learning how to make these things, and we basically don't know yet what they do. So what are the characteristics of CleanCap? So you get efficient capping that's highly reproducible. With our best CleanCap analogs, we regularly get in the very high 90s. For some of the more challenging ones, more like 90. Depending on the sequence at the beginning. We can produce cap zero, cap one, or cap two. We can yield unmodified natural caps, or if you want one with a modification, we can put a whole bunch of different chemistry there. So it opens up the chemistry at the 5' end of your RNA. And it also allows us to put things like M6A or M6AM at the beginning. And I'll show you some data later on in the talk about that. It's much more cost-effective than enzymatic capping. It's easily scalable. And one of the things we like about it is that in an ideal manufacturing world, you would have a synthesis where you do a one-pot reaction, you go to a purification, you filter, you're done. And so being able to co-transcriptionally cap and achieve cap one and cap two structures opens the possibility of a one-pot reaction, as long as all your downstream stuff is compatible with that. So this is an example of a clean cap capping. This one went really well, and the capping is in the probably in the 99%. Range. Here's one that went slightly less well. But we get extremely reproducible and very high levels of capping with our kind of first generation clean caps. And this is just a montage of the three different capping methods, so you can kind of see them sort of side by side. We have ARCA with a lot of uncapped material and a lot of transcriptional stuttering. We have enzymatic capping, which has some incomplete capping here. And then we have CleanCap, which this is the incomplete capping in the CleanCap. And so we're very, very excited about this new technology. And so we've been applying it quite heavily, and we've gotten really nice adoption from the community.